Okay, so anybody who just came in that missed it, if you go to coachesoftech.com and hit the shares link, you can get a SlideShare version of my talk, so you can have it down a little closer to you if you'd like. And actually having that type of a thing is a good tool for accessibility if you're teaching in a classroom. I had a student that was visually impaired, and that's one of the ways I was able to do things for him. Not necessarily that method through SlideShare, but through our campus learning management system, I was able to put it up, and then he could follow right along. Okay, so my name is Trevor Johnson-Steigelman. I am a physics professor at Finger Lakes Community College, which is just on the other side of Rochester in Canandaigua. I also do a little bit of web development, so I have a website that's called physicsthisweek.com that I try to teach from, and I'm always in the process of trying to update those things. And being an educator, accessibility is one of those things that we have to be aware of. And one of the worst things that can happen to you is to suddenly have somebody come into your classroom and need something that you have not planned for at all. And by doing a few minor things, you can really set yourself up for success for that, so you don't have to do a lot of major changes later on. So what I want to give to you today is a few tips on things that you can do as you're working on your website, as you're building pages and so on, that are mostly painless, and they just set you up with things that you might not think of accessibility-wise, but they're going to help out everybody that uses your website. Okay, so in some of the talks, if you were at the Gutenberg talk, they talked about not releasing it until the web content accessibility guidelines were met for those types of things. This is a set of standards that has been pushed through. It is not, it's always evolving as things go on. And there are some people who don't like it and some people who do. But for the most part, it's a very reasonable set of expectations for anything that you're going to put on the web. And I'm not sure who picked the acronym, but if you want a poor website, perceivable, operatable, and not another O, but understandable and robust type of a website, if you look at some of these guidelines, you can find ways to make things so that your tags are good, your fonts are good, your links are good, your images are good, and your contrast and color are good. And as I mentioned, if you don't think about accessibility along the way, it can be a situation where you can get yourself into a bit of a pickle. So this guy, Morten Rand Hendrickson, he's kind of really big in this. He says, make it accessible, make it fancy, make sure that fancy doesn't break accessibility, and then save money, save time, make sure that you're doing these. Accessibility here, with A11LY, or A11Y, they took 11 letters out of the middle of accessibility to make it a little shorter. I don't know how accessible that is, but they've done that with a couple of different words here. But the idea is if you start from accessibility at the beginning and then fancy it up, you're going to be in much better shape. Rather than try to make something that looks really fancy, that looks cool to you, there might be some subtle design things in there that makes it tough for lots of different people to look at. And the reason you want to worry about this is there are lots of us who have some type of a disability. And it's not always the major ones that people think of. You know, so you think of seeing eye dogs and handicapped parking spaces and things like that. There are other types of things. There are people with hand mobility issues, whether it's MS or some other type of a condition where they have trouble centering their mouse. For things. I have an uncle, or had an uncle, who had Parkinson's, and he didn't use the internet much, but he might have had trouble moving his mouse around and trying to get fine details on a website. There's all types of vision impairment. There's all types of hearing impairment. I wouldn't consider myself blind, but my eye doctor told me that one of my eyes, I'm legally blind. When I put my glasses on, I'm fine. And I call them my multifocal lenses because bifocals make me sound old. But I've got some adaptations to that that help me out. But there are some websites that drive me batty because I can't adjust the size of the font and I can't zoom in on my iPad or anything like that. That's an accessibility problem that has made me decide I'm not going to look at some websites. Now, along these lines, this picture here is my steps in my house. My mother-in-law comes to visit. She actually came last night, so I left early in the afternoon so I could be here. That's not quite true. I like my mother-in-law. But she comes to visit us. She has some trouble going up the steps, so we put in the extra guide rail that wasn't there when we had the house built. So we had the contractor come back in and put that in for us. She's at our house maybe 2 to 6 weeks a year. She uses it a couple of times a day going up and down the stairs. I use that thing every morning as I stumble down the steps and sometimes as I stumble up the steps to get back. I wouldn't have thought of that for myself, but it's an accessibility thing that helps me out for that. And even if you don't have a real vision impairment, if you go outside and try to use your phone and you can't see it, if you're designing so that you've got really dark darks and really light lights, it's going to be a little easier to read there. And that's not something that you're thinking really accessibility about, but it's readability to help people out. So all these different things, there's only a couple of percents there, but that's about 15.5 million users have some type of thing going on, and that doesn't count the temporarily impaired. That doesn't count somebody who sprained their wrist. Doesn't count somebody who has a black eye or those types of things. And again, those of us who don't have something that's noticeable, use tiny screens, use things in the sunlight, and so on. So, why worry about this? I'll do the nice guy stuff on this side. It's just being a good person, helping people out, make things easier for everybody. And then the selfish reasons over here is, one, I don't want to get sued by the ADA compliance things. If I can sell my website to a college somewhere, it's going to have to be accessible. And in fact, because I use my website with my students, there are accessibility guidelines that I have to follow for that are by law. This stuff has not come yet to, if you're running a website, you have to do it, but it's not out of the realm of possibility that you will. But if you're in a government site or you're doing something for the government in web development, you have to follow the guidelines. The other things, those 15.5 million people, I would never say, well, I don't want a whole group of, I want to throw out 15 million possible users for that. So doing this type of stuff allows you to sell more stuff to those people. You just generally have more customers available. And Google likes this type of stuff because it makes it easier and more reasonable to read your content. They're big on readability. Accessibility is helping towards readability. Okay, so there's a couple of ways that you can check your accessibility. So if you have a website and you have not done this type of thing yet, if you go to wave.webaim.org and enter your website information, it will give you fairly quickly a page-by-page report. Actually, you have to do it page-by-page, but it'll give you a guideline here on how you're doing with it. And then within here, it's going to give you bits and pieces around your site and tell you what's going on in those places. So if I zoom in on one of these, I had an error, only one error on the page that it called out. So I had an SSL certificate put on, and they said, here's a graphic you can put in to show that you've got that there. I got this kind of diver down type flag there, and if I put my mouse over that on that WebAIM page, it's going to tell me what's going on. This doesn't have any alternate text to it. Now, whether or not I need that, I probably don't, but at least it has let me know. If this had been something up in my content that I didn't have an alt tag for, then it's telling me, hey, you should really put this in. Okay? Other things that it does, it's showing me that I skipped some headings. So I went from H1 down to H4 down in my footer. And it is looking for a hierarchy, and we'll talk about tags in a moment, that follows logically as you go down through. The other thing it told me is I had some contrast errors. And this dark gray text on a black background is not a very good idea. I thought it looked cool, but the contrast isn't good enough there. So I've done some adaptations to make this a little bit better. It also tells you some other things. So it tells you that you've got some features in there. I've got structural elements. Those are not errors. Those are just things that it's saying, hey, you're doing a good job on these types of things. Okay, so let's kind of step through some of these things in kind of these five ways you can help make things better. If you look at this, this is kind of a mess, but if I start to play around with it a little bit, put some heading tags and so on, it eventually becomes much, much more readable for that. So if you would look at the code, it's not very readable. But what this has done, it has organized it for me. It makes a progressive set of things going on. And if you have somebody who is cognitively impaired, having structure to the page is going to help them out. It'll help them keep focus. And those cognitive type things, it could be anything from ADA to some type of brain trauma. It could be somebody who's just trying to skim. They don't need all the details, and they look in. If you've ever gotten an email that's just one wall of text that has no paragraphs in it or anything like that, that's an accessibility problem. And you've probably complained to somebody about that. Or if you have a student that's writing a paper, it's like, put some periods in there, put some spaces in, indent your paragraphs, and so on. This also helps out screen readers, and I'll show you an example of a screen reader in a little bit. Somebody who cannot see the page but is having it read to them, one of the options that they have is to hit one of their buttons and it will skip down to the next heading. So you as a visual person would just zip down the page until you found what you want. Somebody who's using a screen reader would have to wait until it was there because they can't scan things. But putting in tags allows the screen reader to work through that. And also anybody who's using keyboard motions. Usually if you hit tab, it's going to skip down to the next heading level as you go. Okay, and these tags are not really anything beyond making an outline. So it looks like there are people younger than me in here and people around my age. If you remember way back when, we sat down and outlined everything that we were going to do. If you can do that, you can set your web page up. And if you can't, just putting bullets and headings in is going to help you out. So when I was writing this talk, I decided, okay, it's going to be about accessibility. That would be my H1 tag. That's kind of the title of my page level of information. And then as I go through within a PowerPoint presentation, I have the next level down. If it was on a web page, that would be my H2 tag. And then if I go to a different topic, whether it's on a different page or on the same page, I just go down to the next level. I repeat with the H2 in there. And then the subtopics with underneath those, I do H3, then maybe another H3, and then an H4, and so on down through. And I would put my text in around those things. So under the heading tags, I might have a little bit of information about that. And then I have the styles information. I have some information about that. And then if I break it down even further, if you've used the Yoast plugin and it's telling you to help improve your SEO, it says, hey, you haven't used the header, you haven't used any header tags yet. It's doing that, one, so that Google ranks your page a little higher. And Google is making you do that because they want your page to be more readable and therefore more accessible. Okay, and you want to use these tags appropriately. Don't do formatting changes where you just change the font within the page. Do that in your CSS. Set that up so that every tag that you do for your heading tag, your H1 tags, that those are all the same throughout your pages. And then if you decide to change that, you don't have to go through every single page and fix it. Okay? Within the page, though, use your header tags. Don't skip those as you go down. Put that information in the right orders. And all you have to do is, within most of the editors, there's going to be spots where you pick the heading. So if you can see right up there below Add Media, Heading 1, I can just click through that and add Heading 1, Heading 2, make it a paragraph, and so on. That sets up the structure. Yes? So it would be along the lines of somebody thinks, well, wait a minute, did I miss something? Or is it improperly tagged? So it's just trying to keep a hierarchy to it. It's probably not the worst thing you can do. But whenever you're hitting the down thing, so if I'm hitting tab to navigate through, if I have skipped one, it might jump way, way down the page and miss that content in the middle. So if I go to the H1 tag, then the H2 tag, and then it jumps to H4, there might be some semantic, wait a minute, scratch my head, what's going on type of things for it. So it's just a warning that it will give you for that. Again, not the worst thing you can do, but it will give you the notices for those types of things. Okay? And then you can use these phrase tags, which is nice because most of the editors, when you hit the I to make it italics, it's really going to put into the code that it's emphasis. It's going to put in for bold that it's strong. So you don't have to know all these HTML tags for it. It kind of does it for you naturally. But then if you go from this view into the text view, you can see here that this word showing emphasis, this word down here, it is put into the code that it's emphasized. Some of the better screen readers will actually put some emphasis on that. So somebody who's listening to it, you know, if you've ever listened to a mechanical voice just reading something, there's no inflection, things like that, the better screen readers are being developed so that it puts the emphasis where you want it. And you do that naturally when you're speaking. This gives people a way to see that on the page or hear that through the screen reader. Okay, some of these other tags that are there, I use Divi and there's extra tags in there. Most of them are just the ones across the top that will go in. Okay, so here's an example of a screen reader. Okay, and I'm not very good at this, so there's a couple of pauses. Okay, so in going through there, I was hitting tab. Okay, so you could hear there that it actually said aloud heading one, so somebody who's visually impaired listening to this knows what's going on. It's the same thing in your audiobooks where they say chapter two or section five going through. It's helping guide you through there. That's where missing a tag might make somebody say, oh, wait a minute, did I hit my tab key too many times? So having the structure in there is going to help folks out with that. Okay, now, there are some tags for other things, and all of this stuff, you can go really, really deep. But if you do some of the higher level things, you're going to get your 80%, or you do 20% of the things to get 80% of the way there. But there are codings for the World Web Consortium that give you different types of landmarks, and that's going to help people know whether they're in the main setup, whether they're in complementary areas. So these things that would be off to the side, they might be there all the time. The screen reader isn't necessarily going to read these aloud on every page. Just like once you look at it, two or three pages, you're going to kind of ignore that stuff. But if you hit the right combination of keys, it's going to take you to those navigation things if you need it. Okay, moving on to color here. There's a lot of funky things that you can do that really can break your website, break your images. You can see here that nothing is possible. That is not meant to be demotivational. If you look really, really closely, the color of the waves is the color of the text. And then here, color can enhance your website. This stuff with the gradient that looks really cool breaks spots for everybody. And if you have any poor vision at all, you can probably barely see that as you're going on. So there are several different things related to color and contrast. So somebody who has quote-unquote normal vision is going to see the rainbow of colors there. But if you have different types of red, green, blue, yellow, or just monochromacy going on, you lose those things. If you want to find out anything that you have and you don't want to pay the eye doctor to do it, if you go to nchroma.com test, it will show you a series of pictures like these where you can go through, and if you can't see the number in one of those, it's going to give you kind of a diagnosis of what things are going on with your vision for that. This one, I am not sure if I have a problem or if they're just screwing with me on that. So it'll go through and it'll ask you to show the different numbers, or it'll show you different numbers and you type in the number that's there. But I went through and kind of cherry-picked the ones out for it. There's just kind of barely one there. But if, what's that? Okay, okay. Thank you. So, again, these are things that you might think, oh, this is the most wonderful, funky color scheme that I can do, and then you lose some percentage of your viewers through that type of stuff. Okay, so a couple of contrast tips. We've all seen these websites. Somebody said, oh, it's easier on the eyes if the brights and the darks aren't quite so far apart from each other. Bull crap. Do the best contrast that you can get. There are several websites that I have stopped using because they don't give me the option to do that. Now, for a while there, within the different browsers, there's ways that you could set it, but then there's always another browser that comes out, and so I've just decided that some of these I'm going to stop looking at because of those contrast things. And if you're going to set these, make sure you set the foreground and the background so that the contrast, somebody's using the dark mode in their browser, it's going to pick a nice dark mode and switch the text for you. Okay, be careful of the color gradients, especially when you've got different colors going on. So people who can see red and green are going to have trouble with this one. People who can't see red and green, it's even worse for that. Okay, and many, many themes will give you an option for an image in the background. Don't do that, because I lose different colors of text here. And even if I fade it out in the background, it still can cause some problems, especially if there's a feature in the image that makes a one letter look like a different letter for that. Now, if you want to check the colors on your website, again, webaim.org has some resources where you can actually go in and pick out different colors. So if you go into this, somebody said in the last one, don't use live demonstrations, and I thought I could do it, which is why I have put my screenshot in here. So on my website, I had just made it. It was physicsthisweek.com, and I felt really good about myself. So I went out and bought a hat to put the logo on, and I went through and I picked out the hat color that I really liked, and then I picked out the thread color that I really liked. I thought, oh, that sets that off very nicely. Put it on, brought it home, and then tried to make my website look like the hat, because he didn't have 15 million colors in his threads or in his hats. But I tried to match it, and then it turns out that on many levels here, I failed in the contrast test. And notice that there's different levels. You want to go for the highest level that you can with these. And so the contrast level has to be 7:1 for normal text, and it's not quite as bad for larger text. But it's only this really large text that passes for this. So I was getting errors on my website that said, here's contrast problems. So somebody who was looking at this might miss the fact that there's links down at the bottom or links up at the top for that. And it's a relatively easy thing to fix. So in your customizer, you can go in and pick out the different colors. If you look at the colors that you have, it's going to give you a hexadecimal number, you know, series of letters and numbers that tells you what the color is. You go to this page, just type it in those two spots, and it's going to give you a score for that. And a lot of times it's just a little tweak, and it'll actually allow you to slide them a little bit. So I didn't do a huge change. It was just I knocked one up a little bit and one down a little bit and fixed that problem within my page. Okay, the other place you want to watch out for is make sure that you're using more than one signal to connote meaning in here. So if you look closely at these stoplight things, most intersections, red is at the top, yellow's in the middle, green's at the bottom. Apparently somewhere in Syracuse, there were riots at some point because the Irish thought that the green should be on top of the red, the damn Brits. And they fought back and forth for a while, but they eventually realized that with the accidents and things that they needed to do it this way. A lot of intersections have those lights across. You saw those for a while. You don't see as many of those as you used to because the meaning was changed, and it's hard to tell in those situations. And that's the type of thing, even for people who don't have color problems, if you're suddenly doing things differently, it causes problems. Just before this talk, I went to use the restroom. And you look and they've got all those funky lines going on. I thought, oh, that's really cool. And then I went to the side that I think is usually the men's room. There's no sign on the door. You have to back up 5 steps and look way up there to see that. So luckily, I stopped and paused for a second and did that and didn't get myself into trouble or on any type of a list for walking into the wrong restroom. But typically, because we bleed red, we use red for errors and green for good things. Somebody who's colorblind can't see that. So give the name on the button as well as a color scheme for it. So, like I said, I teach physics, so I have different graphs and so on. A lot of times, people might print something out. We don't do it as much as we used to, but a lot of times people will print. You lose that color if you go across. So where this is not a problem accessibility-wise too much, somebody with some color issues might not see that, but everybody that prints it out is going to have trouble with it. So what you can do is give a little different meaning, having dots and dashes instead of those types of things, instead of just color differences for those. Okay? And then with your links, you know, adding into this, you know, the next thing that you can look at with your links, when you've got topics like that, it's not just the physics that scares people off. It's all that in there. And I've actually set my, my slugs to try to be somewhat readable. But if you're using dates and numbers and random things that go in there, you don't set that, it's going to make that even more horrible. And now it's this long and it's going to wrap sometimes around your page. Try not to use those directly as links. Go down and use your anchor text. And you can look up guidelines for that. But what that's going to do is give a nice small word. The screen reader is not going to have to read a lot. People are not going to have to search in there to find out what that topic is about. Use informative structure. People move away from the lines and underlines. You know, way back when, every link was blue, every follow link was purple. Probably want to stick with that, even if it clashes a little bit with your color scheme, because it gives meaning as you go through that. Okay? When you have a screen reader, when you hit tab, it's going to move from spot to spot. It's going to hit the header tags. It's going to hit the links, and it will say what the links are. Some of them say link, not all of them do for that. But by using your anchor text, you help your SEO tremendously, but you also help people out. Here's an article about using links properly. For more information about links, click here. I've seen that on many, many web pages, and then I'm thinking, well, where's the link? You know, do I actually click there? Do I click past it? And sometimes people will say click here, and the information about links will be the thing that's the actual tag for that. So make sure that it's there reasonably. Click here, that's better than the line above, but you don't get as much SEO juice out of that because everybody has a tag that says here. Only you have one that says using link properly or magnitude and direction in physics. Okay? The other thing is the screen readers, if you are using your anchor text, if it opens in a new window, you can set up the tag to say that. But if you make it say, you know, make the person wait for link opens in a new window products, link opens in a new window about, links open in a new window, and so on, that's going to get real annoying real fast. Just like the fifth time you call back to customer service and you have to go through that menu system and you just keep hitting four and then three because I almost know the sequence, but then I mess up on the last one and I have to recall back. You want to try to avoid that type of thing. And be concise with your wording. In order to contact us, that's way too long of a link. The understanding of most people is contact us means get us. You could probably even just put contact for that. About is good enough these days. That's kind of the code that most people have gone in. It's a little better to have more words, but when your links start going all over the page in your header, that can be troublesome. It can cause errors. You can put things out of the color range that you want for them. Okay? And most of us put images of some type. Thank you. Most of us put images of some type into our talks or into our web pages. The alt text is a description or a context that tells you what's going on with something. So somebody who can't see this picture will at least have an idea that there's a picture there of Albert Einstein. We call them alt tags, but it's really an attribute, but that's something web designers can get in big fights about. Obviously, you wouldn't want to use all this as your link information, but you can actually see in here, this is Albert Einstein hidden in there. Yeah. Yes. Exactly, because the screen reader might read all that stuff, depending on the settings for the screen reader. And it's just going to read all those types of things. So you're trying to, you know, Google knows better with all that tag stuffing and going on. So be wary of that. Thank you. Okay, and you can control this whenever you add media to your page. You can go in and set these things up. So we've all seen this type of page, or you can fill out the form for it. The title, you want to make sure that the title has meaning. Don't just call it picture one, picture two, picture three. That helps you when you want to go back and look in your files to see where it's at. The alt text, you want to just have a brief description of it. This part that is the description, and here's a wording problem. This description is not what the screen reader reads. That is SEO type stuff that when you go to the attachment page, it's going to show the picture and the description of it that you put in. So if I want to get my name out there a little bit more for my pictures, I put that in on that page. And that gives me more Google juice towards my own name. Okay, and if you do a mouse over, or if you have a really poor internet connection, it's going to show you what that information is in the alt text, so that you can decide, am I going to wait for this thing to load, or am I going to go on? Or if you're doing it on your own page and you see that, you know what you meant to put in there 6 years ago when you put this on the page. So again, you can help yourself out. Okay, you don't have to recopy everything as you go through. Just in the interest of time, I'm not going to spend all the time on these. If it's only the image or that's a link, you must have an alt attribute, because that's what the screen reader is going to read for that. So if you have pictures, for example, this page goes into how you would tag that famous portrait of George Washington. If it adds nothing to the discussion, you don't even have to say that it's there. Why say, or you can't see the picture for that? But if it's a link, you do need to put it in there. Or you might put in a portrait of George Washington for that. Okay. Accessibility and helping people out in general. I don't know what your politics are, but developing websites or any web content that automatically plays sound files is now punishable by death. That's a law I think we can all get behind. Again, there's some news sites that I just don't even follow the links to them anymore, because I know that at some point it's going to put in, it's going to start playing things. And if I've already scanned the page and moved on and didn't close that tab, it's suddenly going to start yelling at me and probably showing me a commercial for that. But if you do put videos or anything like that onto your website, if you do it through YouTube will actually go through, and it used to take a couple of hours, it's now within a couple of minutes, maybe 15 minutes. That video will have very poor closed captioned on it. So if you ever watched like CSI, the closed captioning is perfect. But if you watch the local news, it's kind of just jumping all over the place. It's on that local news level because it's done automatically for that. But you can go in and put in the periods, put in the capital letters, fix things like this one. So I was showing people what happens if you put a glass bottle or a plastic bottle outside on a really cold day, and the closed captioning came out. You take a look at the top bitch really getting steamy inside. That is absolutely not what I said. I said, if you look at the top, it is, well, I probably said it's, really getting steamy inside. So you do have to go back and look at those things. But when you do this, you're going to benefit everybody. Confusing words are spelled out. If you have English as a second language, folks, they can pick their own language and put it in, or they can learn the English words a little bit better. If you are putting things up, people can watch it on their screen on the subway. And if their earbuds are, if they've dropped their earpods or whatever they call them, if you've lost those, you can still watch the video. If somebody's trying to talk to you while you're, you know, trying to sit at the dinner table and watch videos, you know, they don't have to listen to the sound of what you're watching for it. And let's see. Oops. Okay, and SEO stuff, this is the, the selfish end of things for it. That postage, you can post the transcript, you can copy that stuff out, that's more link juice for you. You get a boost from that. The SEO, there's somewhere in that algorithm that readability is in there, that it's closed captioned, it's going to move up the ranks rather than down the ranks for that. And then you can take that stuff and do a blog post with your video and all those types of things that help you out in addition to helping everybody else out. So since it was Star Wars Day yesterday, in the real last one, Return of the Jedi, in that one, there's a line that the Emperor says about a sanctuary moon. And I watched that so many times on DVD, or not DVD, on VHS, trying to figure out what the heck is he saying. And then I had the DVD for a while before I realized, oh, I can use the closed captions. And I finally found out that he wasn't saying blah, 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 blah. He was saying, your friends on the sanctuary moon are in there. So that helped everybody out. Well, at least it helped me out. Fonts, picking out good fonts. It used to be if it was in print, you put the serifs on it, the little fancy things. On screens, you did not do that. These days, you can use either serif or not. All of these are fairly good fonts to use on your website. They have good accessibility scores. Verdana is actually the most preferred because of the ways its ones and L's and all those types of things fit together. But it's kind of big, but it also scales pretty well. It doesn't look pretty, but if you look, you find a pretty font, you can check the accessibility score and see if it makes sense. Okay, all of these fonts are at 38 point on this screen. Please don't use these. Write these all down. Okay, we're near Niagara Falls, so I put that one in. These are all fonts that you're going to lose people over because they can't read them, whether it's because these damn kids, they can't read cursive these days. And it's just hard to read, right? So if your daughter's getting married and you don't like the guy, pick that script out for the wedding invitations and so on. But, you know, it has different types of problems with those. Now, kind of tying this all together, improving stuff helps everybody. It helps you, it helps your viewers, it helps people who are impaired, people who are not impaired, people who are temporarily impaired. So I'm not going to read those all to you, but think about these types of things as you're going. And if you have the link, and I'll put the link to the link back up in a moment, but there's all kinds of resources here. You can really dig deep in this, but seriously, if you just look at the pages that you're making and say, oh, I'm not just going to change the font here, I'm going to change the header tag, and you start putting that process into place as you build more pages onto your website, it's going to be so much better for everybody. So again, there's some simple things you can do. Make sure that it's good before it's accessible before it's fancy, and then don't break the accessibility. Okay, does anybody have any questions? Yeah. Okay, yep, so. So I just started using a new control from my phone. It's the Microsoft remote, Office remote. I seem to have lost my... So if you go to coachesoftech.com, all put together, the link to the far right is shares. If you click on that link, then it will give you the horrible looking actual link to the talk on SlideShare. So it's coachesoftech.com. Go to the shares link, and then you've got a link to SlideShare. And it's all up there. Other questions? Yes. I put it up to YouTube, and I waited 15 minutes. And they do it. If you look, let's see if I can get this back up onto the screen. So you go in and put it in. Within your Creator Studio, there's a link there that says subtitles and closed captioning. It does it automatic, and then you just need to clean it up. So again, I work in education. If I want to put something on my website or on my school page, it has to be closed captioned. So depending on how your IT department is, they might say, can you do it some other way? Because we don't have enough funds to get everything caught up. Everybody's starting to go online, we need to do this and things. You can do it yourself just like that. And then you don't have the big file, you can just put the link to YouTube and it's all pretty well done. And it's really not, it's a good job for a student to do, but it's something you can do yourself. I mean, if you put up your videos in small chunks, so like all my lessons, I don't do an hour, because who wants to sit through an hour of physics? But I'll do it in like 8 or 9 minutes of video, and I can fix the closed captioning within 10 minutes. You know, it's really not hard to do. And if you have videos that are already up, you go in, I'm sure that the automatic ones are already there. And you can just fix it real quick. Yeah. I think so, but I'm not certain. Okay. So it is about lunchtime, and I'm getting the cut back there. But if anybody has any other questions and you want to stick around, we can do that, but if anybody wants to head out to get in line first, you can. But if you want to come up and ask me questions, please feel free. Thank you.